Hi, I'm Sterling Allen of Pure Energy Systems News, PESN.com online. And I'm here in Cambuquita, Brazil, with the Kepi Motor Group. They have a motor that is in production that consumes just one third the amount of electricity that most motors of its size or output, you take energy from the wall, the amount of energy you get out, one third the amount of electricity required. And this is a motor that can be applied to a lot of different applications. In this case, they're putting it in a fan. And what we want to talk to you today about is not just a motor, but a concept of a group that's working together to bring these things to production. You'll notice that the motor is really a nice piece of equipment. This is handcrafted, it looks good. Not only that, but the motor actually has some health benefits, as you can imagine, and that's a whole nother discussion. We'll touch on it just a little bit in this overview of how you make one of these things, but that's actually what we want to talk about today, is making one of these things. We want you to get excited about getting a group of entrepreneurs, local activists, local conscious people who want to get a business together, start a company, and actually a co-op, a group of people who are working together to make the future. This is a technology, it's very exciting. And so I've been traveling the world for almost 11 years now, looking for practical, exotic free energy technologies that are ready to go to market that will transform society. And I'm glad to say that this technology is a transitional technology. It's not going to be long before the engineers who are working on this technology will have greater output, one horsepower. They already have something that has that kind of output. They're not ready to turn that into kits like they are this one. They have kits for this. You can go to their website, kepimotor.com, and download the plans. You can start making these things. And in the future, not too long from now, you might be able to run this thing without a cord. So come with us now and get a tour of how we make these things and how you can create a community like they've done here. Thank you.
Oh, hi Sterling, how are you?
Hi, sir.
Great. I'm very happy to receive you here in our Kepi Motor fan workshop. Would you like to see the steps?
I would love to, and I just want to mention what's really exciting to me about your setting here is that it really makes me feel, it reminds me almost of the manger, a very humble beginning. You know, you're outside, almost looks like a shack, and yet it's a clean, you know, functional setting right next to your main production facility.
Exactly. The Kepi motor is a very, very simple motor that everyone can do. Yeah. And we will show you the steps. And we start in a very humble place, like you can see here. In the workshop, we buy the wood ourselves. We cut with simple tools.
Now, in talking about these humble beginnings, maybe you can explain why you're in this particular circumstance and not inside where all the rest of the action takes place.
Well, starting like every woodwork, you always deal a lot with glues and sawdust. This is not healthy to be in a closed place. So we chose to be here close to the garage. As you can see, it's a very simple place. Every house has a place like that. We can start so easily. And I will show you how simple it is. Once you have very simple basic tools, you can do the entire process of producing a Kepi motor fan, for example, from beginning to end. It's very, very simple and cheap if you consider the final product, because when you see the final product, it's really a piece of art. And this encourages people to use their creativity. You can do not only a simple fan, but you will be doing, that's the idea, you'll be doing a very high-tech piece of technology there inside a woodwork that you can use also your aesthetic sense to make a really a fine piece of art. Would you like to come inside and then I start to show you the first step? So,
well, from the beginning, when we're going to make this fan, we need to prepare the wood. First of all, we have to cut this sides and the back of the fan, you see? It's made in plywood. Plywood, it has to be, the size needs to be enough for flexible. Bending or, you know, flexible. So when we have, of course, when you have like this, we design the pedestal of the fan, like here. So we take the molds from what we want to cut first, like in here, we do a mold, and then we do the cutting. It can be done by jigsaw or kind of similar. It can be a table jigsaw. Okay, so when you have these parts done, we need to do this head, I would call head of the fan, you see? Where it goes the motor on the back. So this part has to be done in CNC machine, okay? If the person doesn't have a CNC machine, it can be done by hand with a jigsaw. The important thing is this center. It has to be well done, and the four holes also, because it's important when you put the motor back that it stays like centralized, straight, centralized, not in a wrong way. Okay, this, when we have this part done, we can nail, you see, there is a nail here, and we can glue with a white glue this part, okay? So when this is done, in Brazil we have a lot of vinyl, kinds of vinyl.
Veneer.
Yeah, veneer, sorry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, veneer, that you can use to cover, to do the covering of the pedestal. And also we have the base. The base can be done in MDF. You can cut in two parts, like in this.
This is not round. Finished yet.
It's not finished yet, okay? And this part is like this because in here we will have the circuits here. So
the circuit.
The circuit, yeah. And when you have this, when you make it nice round, also you can do the veneer that you have choose. So you can do this part, do the pedestal, and then after, in here you see a hole where we install the switch. Here will be the circuit, and this can be the lock of the bottom where when we have this part done, we can install also feet here, okay? So it will be more or less like this. And then we fix it, not this, in this part. We fix it the head of the fan, like in here. And we can screw here, okay?
So we can have, like you say, two different possibilities. This is one fixed possibility, right? When you put this piece here, or you can make a hole in here and make it articulated as well, you know? And then you can have two different possibilities.
Okay, we're back inside now, and we're gonna go through the sequence inside. We're gonna start with Will, he's from Canada. And he does the lathe stuff.
Yes, we make our own shafts for the motor here. We use a simple metal lathe. We buy our 8mm stock in about 8-foot lengths. And we cut it up. You can either use a hacksaw or a metal saw. And then we finish it up in the metal lathe. We clean up the ends here and here. We add the seat for the bearing and the magnetic hexagonal support shaft. And then we add the reverse threads for the fan blade. It'll come on here like this and like that. After that is done, we add a hole, which facilitates the fan blade. So we put our stock in the metal lathe like so. And now we're going to add the bearing seat. It's a very simple matter, once you have the right tools. Just make a simple groove like that. Facilitates the bearing. Like that. This is for the magnetic hexagonal steel support that we'll add later. And the bearing also. Now we're going to add the threads. We're using just a standard reverse threading tool you can pick up at any hardware store. It's very simple. Put a little bit of lubricant oil. It's much easier with this piece of equipment here to get a straight, proper thread on the shaft. Once it gets started, it's very easy. And there you have the beginnings of the thread. So you just keep going like that until it's up to here, and then that's it.
Okay, now we are to what is really the heart of this Kepi motor, the motor body. And Cesar's going to explain to us how this works. It's really amazing. So there's a lot of things here that are going to blow the scientist away that they've never seen anywhere else. Cesar.
Okay, Sterling, after that work we do there, in the workshop, these pieces here, you can see, they are very simple. You can build up a motor with very simple pieces. This piece can be done by a CNC machine, if you have one, uh-huh. or cutting by hand using a jigsaw. These two pieces, you have here the rotor, these two support pieces.
Is this? And you can come this isn't up. Wood, is it?
Yeah, phenolite, wood, it can be wood because the motor doesn't heat up, you know, so...
You could use plastic.
Plastic, wood, whatever, you know. We use this phenolite because the support is much like stronger against humidity, for example. And then this is the final product that you have. You have the rotor inside and the supports with the spacers and screws. It's very important not to use ferromagnetic screws because otherwise they will attract the magnets of the rotor and will prevent the motor to run freely. Right. Okay, and after that we can wind the coils in this situation here, and this is the final result. You have that support with the coil winded up like this. Okay, so this is the motor. So let's take a look inside, what's happening inside. This is what is the crucial point. You have the magnet here, and here imagine that the coils are winded this way, right? So you have the magnetic axis of the coil in this direction, and you have the magnetic axis of the magnet, the permanent magnet, in this direction. You notice that I wrote here north, the north polarity of the magnet, and I make it in such a way that the north polarity of the coil will be here too. When the motor starts to pulse, I turn on the coils, I will create a north polarity here with the north polarity of the magnet, the rotor. They will tend, the rotor will tend to align and stop in this position. But before it does so, when it's 120 degrees up after this point, I shut off the circuit. When I shut off exactly this moment, 120 degrees from here, I receive a peak of voltage in the coils. This peak of voltage has many interesting properties, and this is what is extremely different from any other motor.
Now pay attention to this.
Look, the conventional motors, for example, they simply go up to here and they change polarity and they continue. They change polarity of the coil and continue, change polarity and continue, and does so all the time, and so on. This one, the Kepi motor, does like that. Pay attention, look, it goes here 120 degrees, here we shut off the circuit. When I shut off the circuit, I receive the peak of voltage. this peak of voltages is much higher than the voltage of the power supply that is feeding the motor. Mm-hmm. Suppose you are feeding the motor with 110 volts. Mm-hmm. This peak of voltage will be normally about 450, 500 volts. This peak can ionize the air.
Ionize
the air in between the coils, mm-hmm. you know? And this ionization will create, will purify the air and cool the air also. So when you apply this motor for a fan, for example, the fan is blowing a fresh air, much fresh, cooler than the regular fans, and also...
Because it's not hot, it's, but also there's this cooling effect.
Yes, you're right. It's not hot, first. Mm-hmm. Second, is there is this ionization property, which is freshening up the air, the food. You know, in science we know that when you have ionized air, it's good for health.
There's even some ozone that shows up?
Yeah, some people, they are sensitive and they can feel the ozone smell.
And ozone is very good for health.
Very good for health. It's yeah. similar. You can imagine after a thunderstorm, mm-hmm.
It smells so good.
The feeling yeah. you have after a thunderstorm, yeah. the air, the temperature goes down and you feel good.
There's also some health stuff, even for the magnetic pulsing, that's different from a regular motor that, like, the cast will run away from a regular motor. Yeah. But with this motor, the cast, like, come up and sit next
yes,
to the motor.
Yes, you are right. Yeah. According to Dr. Kepi's new physics, he says that all phenomena in nature, they follow the same principles. So a device working with this energy, essential energy, he calls, mm-hmm. through the pulses, we can capture this essential energy from the environment. And the waves of this motor, if you watch it in the oscilloscope, is similar to the heart.
Interesting.
Which means it has the capacity to enter in resonance with living beings. So it enters in resonance with living beings, is natural for a living being, for an organism. It doesn't matter if it's a cat or a plant or a human being, he will feel good in the presence of this. You know, Sterling, I have been to the Rio Plus 20
conference,
and when we have our fans working on top of the table, many kids, 5 years old, 4 years old kids, they stopped and looked at the fan and said to their parents, "Daddy, look at that fan, look at that fan, it's so cool, so nice, there is something different about it, come and take a look." The children are very sensitive to this energy and they can perceive it much better than us adults.
Like the cats.
And cats too.
You know, let's go back to this position right here. We talked about the pulse between the electromagnetics or between the coils. But also, aren't you gathering some of that energy like into a capacitor or something like that? Let's talk about that for
yes,
a second.
Yes, this is the next yeah. point. When you remember that I said it, the pulse starts here, 120 degrees, it stops.
Yeah.
When it stops, I let the rotor come up to the same position again and restart another pulse, and restart another pulse. Shut off, on, off, on, off, on, and then so on. This creates a resonance mm-hmm. in the motor. And in resonance, we know in physics that a system like that, oscillatory system, in resonance has the best efficiency. This is one point. And the second point, the moment we shut off the circuit, the peaks of voltage, they can be absorbed by a capacitor, deviated through a capacitor, mm-hmm. and the capacitor will have normally a higher voltage than the voltage supplying the motor from the grid.
So you store that.
Store that.
And then put it back in.
You can use it in an open circuit, mm-hmm. like applying it for other loads, like LEDs, lamp LEDs.
Okay.
LED lamps. Or you can reapply it to the motor.
Do you do that in this particular case?
Not in the case of the fan, but okay. it's very easy and we can do it.
Okay.
It's just for a matter of
something
simplicity.
That came to me as you were talking.
Yeah.
Dr. Kepi talks about disinverted physics.
Yes.
And it seems to me that right here, where you are gathering that energy and that spike that happens, that's the disinversion. This is normal right here, what the motor normally does. Yeah. Could you say that metaphorically, that's the disinverted point where...
Yes, exactly, okay. Mr. Turney. There is much, much more that enters into play in this
philosophically.
Phenomenon. Not only philosophically, okay. But technically speaking. Okay. That's why some people may say, well, you were producing a fan with such a piece of technology. But yes, this technology can be applied to anything, you know? What happens is that when you have a magnet inside the coil, It is also a generator. We cannot forget that.
Yeah.
And the two waves, in this case, because you use pulses in the motor, the generator waves, they overlap the motor waves. And then you have like a conjunction of waves that change the polarity of the magnet naturally.
Yeah, maybe we can talk more later in another episode about this particular point, but just really briefly, isn't there even the magnets themselves, the permanent magnets, are flipping polarity just briefly in this process?
Yes, and we can show this in the oscilloscope.
And that's probably where the quote-unquote free energy attributes are coming from.
Enters into play, yes, in a system. Yeah.
But that's for scientists, and that could be another episode. Let's go to the next station.
Yes,
Are we done here?
Yes, I think it's enough for
okay.
here.
Let's and really quick, let me just mention that you'll notice that this is an injection molded piece that the most recent you did 2,000 runs on this and you know for in allowing these plans to go out to people who want to replicate this, you could give them the CNC all the instructions so they can make these things out of wood. This is the exact same, almost the same design.
Pieces like that or wood in a CNC.
So that comes with the kit or with the instructions, and they would have all that information. They don't have to reproduce this. They go straight to a local manufacturer. Put it in their injection molding machine and squirt these things out and off you go, you're in business, right?
This is it.
Here we are with Will. He has put a lot of time into this manual, as you'll be able to see, to tell you how to make one of these things. So Will, go ahead and explain what you've done here.
I put together this assembly manual for the Kepi Motor fan kit. And it's in order to show people who are interested in building their own Kepi Motor fan kit or their own Kepi Motor how to do it step by step as simply as possible. So we start with an explanation of the theory of the Kepi Motor, how it works from Dr. Kepi's new physics. And we go through explaining each scientific principle. And then we get into the actual kit itself. There's the components of the kit. Everything is labeled, laid out, so it's easy for the person to see.
Look at the quality, isn't that amazing?
We digitally illustrated each component to make it easier to explain the assembly and different things in it. List of tools, and as you can see, it's very simple. Most people who have a garage or who are handy have these tools available to them, or they can be purchased very cheaply. And again, we go through this step by step. Every detail explained. This is all built by us, so we understand a lot of the things that might come up, a lot of questions or problems that the person might have. We understand that because we went through them ourselves. So it's all illustrated here. We get into the motor. You can see inside of the motor with the digital illustration exactly how to put it together. And in this case, we have the mold, but this can apply to any other design. The concept is the same. One of the more important things is the winding of the coil wire onto the bobbin support of the motor. It's illustrated here perfectly. Installation of the motor, putting it onto the pedestal, how to connect the wires to the motor to solder them. It's all detailed here. How to time the pulse of the motor, which is one of the more difficult and important steps, is illustrated here. It talks about why, how to do it correctly. If this isn't done correctly, then the efficiency of the motor isn't going to be where it should be, or it won't work at all. So this is very important. Simple things like installing the blade pin, the guards, very straightforward. And we're always available for questions also.
Do you want to show them that illustration, the animation that you did, where you have all the pieces coming together?
Sure. I built a simple computer animation here. This was a demo to show the team on what we could do, but it shows the parts coming together. So this could be made, and I will make one that shows the whole fan, every component coming together. Very simple. To give a person the visual aspects of the build. Most people are visual, so this is designed to cater to that.
We ready to go to the windings?
Yes.
All right.
Let's go.
Okay, now we're gonna go to Will explaining how we do the winding of the coils.
For this, we're gonna use our standard plastic mold. We use a machine in our factory to wind the coil onto the mold, but that's not necessary at all. We've also wound many times by hand the copper wire onto the motor bobbin support. That can be done by hand, or a person who is handy can make themselves a jig. You can use, for example, we use a motor here like this. It's a very simple setup. You can build something like this. You can use an electric drill on one end to spin this if you want. There's many different ways. Over there, we've used a washing machine motor on our other jig to wind. So it's very simple. So I'm going to show you how it's done right now. We have our finished coil. Spins freely, and that's it. Okay, so to speed things up, we have one that I finished here earlier, and we added masking tape to secure the wires so they won't unwind. We have a thermal fuse that we added. This is to protect the motor from, if it overheats, if there's a problem with a circuit or anything like that, this cuts the power after a certain temperature to the motor so it won't melt. We secure the plastic bushing with hot glue, just normal hot glue. We add a plastic washer here to make sure that the wires don't come in contact with the shaft. We do a test to make sure it spins and you can't hear any noise. And ready to go. Finished motor.
Now we are to the brains of the operation. Cesar, explain us how the brains work that tells everything what to do.
Yes, and the master of operation of electronics is Inger from Sweden.
Hello, I'm a retired engineer and I have worked in ABB in Sweden. And now I love to work in this to try to do something good for the planet and for humanity. Maybe you could show.
Yeah. Using her expertise in electronics, we decided to make a very simple circuit so everybody can do. What you see here is a phenolit plate covered with copper, you see? And then we draw, we have the design in a silk screen of the circuit, of this design we have here in the silk screen. We put it here, and then we apply paint on top of it, a special paint that will serve cover the copper and protect the copper, because afterwards we will pass a sodium perchloratum. It's a kind of acid that will corrode the copper, but not only the exposed copper will be corroded. And afterwards we clean up the paint and we have the tracks in copper. This is very, very simple to do.
And mention also that even, you know, this is your end result, is the copper is exposed, you have your circuit. And not everyone's going to have this equipment. You could do this with a breadboard that you could get from Radio Shack.
For sure. Yeah. It's not practical for the fan because it's too big. But with the breadboard that you can just pin the components, you can do it. Mm-hmm. This is a way to industrialize it a little bit more and very simple way to do it.
Right.
So after we have this, we cut in a little machine like that, you know, we cut, and then we have this as the final product, okay? Mm-hmm. Then we pass to this place here, this table.
Also, you missed the drilling. You got the drill.
Oh yeah, I forgot to say the drilling. Then we have the drawing here. And then we need to make the holes to insert the components and solder them. So we use this a very simple and little drill, electric drill, that we do the drilling here in the specific points where the components can be inserted, okay? Where, what are the components? When you see on this table, you see they are all here. They are so simple and you can find everywhere, very close to your house. The most complicated thing here, here you have diodes, you have capacitors, resistors, simple. And the most complicated thing here you have is the MOSFET, but you also is easy to find, and the optical sensor. This composes the switching of the circuit,
right,
to give the pulses. This gives the pulses in the circuit. After we have inserted these components in the plate, we have this as the final result. This is the final result. A very simple circuit, as you can see here. These four diodes, they serve to get the energy, alternate current from the grid, and they transform into DC current, filtered by this capacitor, and you have a DC filtered current to be switched by this MOSFET together with this optical sensor. All the time, a blind passes through it. And this is what gives the pulse to the motor.
So you're taking the regular current from the main power,
yes,
running it into this, turning it into something that can turn the motor.
You saw the whole picture. This circuit makes it possible for you to use AC current from the grid, DC current from a battery, and also for photovoltaic panels, you can use it. So simple, it works in, it's a universal circuit.
Even in Brazil, when you have brownouts and the power goes down to almost zero, the fan's still turning.
It's still turning, yes, yeah. It turns. Yeah. Even if you were working in 110 volts and for any reason the tension, the voltage goes down to 20 volts, it will continue working, you know? It's an advantage.
And also we should mention, we mentioned before, but this circuit uses the motor uses 1/3 the amount of electricity that a normal fan uses. That's amazing. 1/3 the amount of electricity. This motor is so efficient. That's why you want to be implementing this motor, not just for fans, but other applications.
Yeah, especially compressors for refrigerators.
Yeah.
So Sterling, let's take this circuit because the next step is to see if it's working properly. And who does this job is Inger. Let's come here and see.
And then this is for the AC power. This in the fan goes to the coil. And this is the sensor that says, I mentioned that this.
Yes, in other words, we are replacing the motor for another load, which is the lamp. All the time she closes, she passes the blind through this optic sensor here, you see the current, 110 volts, will pass through the circuit. All the time she closes the sensor, this lamp should work. It will give the pulse. You can try in here.
Oh, I have to
plug. You see?
This one is okay.
That simple.
Yes, very simple.
Very simple, and the tools are very simple as well.
Okay.
Let's go to the next station then.
Next station it is.
Now we're to the place where we put the brain, the circuits, in the body. Cesar, do you want to explain how we do this?
Yeah, and imagine who does this. This is Haimo.
I come from Finland. I'm a retired person and I want to do something good the rest of my life. And this is the Keppemotor. I'm a Keppemotor fan.
Very good. In many ways, right?
Yes, yes.
Could you say this is the Keppemotor fan club?
Yes.
So what is your work here in general? You do what?
I want to put together this woodwork, so this pedestal and circuit come from Inger. And then I put these together, and result is this.
Okay, this is the result. So I can explain in detail what takes place here. This part that Raimo does is to combine the electric work, the electronic work, and the woodwork. Mm-hmm. So it's an electro-electronic work. He will install, for example, in this body, he takes the switch, mm-hmm. on and off switch. He takes the circuit, mm-hmm. fixes here. He takes the cord, the power cord, passes through here, okay? And then, in the end, he installs, he fixes a resistor. A resistor has the function to diminish the speed of the fan. Many people acquainted with the field of electronics and electric will say, oh, this is to spend energy. But this is the simplest way to reduce the speed of a fan, of a motor, is by placing a resistor in the line.
Rather than circuitry.
Yeah, because otherwise it would spend much more and it would be much more complicated. And it works fine because the CAPI motor consumes very, very little energy.
Okay.
After that, we install the back cover, the bottom cover, and it's ready. After, of course, I forgot here, but we pass the optic sensor through this hole, and then we install here. And then we have as a final product, this pedestal with the optic sensor installed, the main cables running up to be connected to the motor, and the circuit installed. Then it's ready to receive the bottom cover and go for testing. Let's see the testing then.
Okay.
Pedestal is ready.
Okay, now we're to the point where we're going to put the heart and the muscle in the body to make this thing work. So tell us how we do that.
And this is Roberto's job. Roberto, explain to us how you do that.
Right. Well, we have the motor CAPI, so we take the pedestal and then we install in the back. We have to be careful to put in the right angle, right? So when we have it here, we introduce with the screws, we fix it, and then we come to a critical point that is the blade that make the balance, the pulse of the motor. And we have to install this blade right in the middle of the optical, so that makes the circuit work. And we're going to need also a magnet that to put in the north pole. Thank you. So we put in the north pole here and we adjust the blade right in the middle of the optical.
Yeah, you see, Sterling, he's saying that when you point the magnet north polarity upwards, then you bring the north polarity of the motor to this position, and then you can adjust the blade here.
Now, would you say this is the most technical part of the whole process?
Yes, it's tricky part.
And do you think if Roberto could handle this, and maybe anyone could do it?
If he can do, anyone can do it.
So easy.
Right. So easy.
So you see, after that, you can explain here. This is the ready part already installed.
Here is already installed. And we have here on the back, I have some blades. I want to show you that we have 30 centimeters blade and 40 centimeters that you readily can get in the market. Okay?
Off the shelf.
Off the shelf. And here we have the last thing, important thing to do is the magnet. You see here, there is a magnet that does the starting of the motor. So this magnet, about this size, we put it here in the back, you see?
So it's off center, otherwise it could be right on center. When you turn the power on, it doesn't want to go anywhere.
Doesn't want to go, that's right.
Now when you turn the power on, it's off center, so it's...
It's the simplest way without a special circuit to get him started.
Very simple.
So when you have done this part, you can glue it, you can fix it here, and then you install the grill and the blade. It's ready for test. We can do a test
right now. We have the test
here, 110.
Very
voila, it's working. Okay?
Okay, a very important step now that before going to the finishing station and to the market, we have to test the motor we did. So here we have the test station. And in this test station, we have a variac which varies the voltage that I need if the motor is 127 volts or 230 volts. And we have here a power meter to measure the consumption. So what I will do, in this case we have a 127 volts motor, I will turn into 127 volts here. When I reach the right voltage, which is this, okay, 127, around that, I turn on the motor and I can measure how much it is consuming. The motor is consuming now at about 22 watts. The speed of rotation of this motor now is 1360 RPM, 1365 RPM or less. So this motor is being much more economic because the conventional one consumes 40 watts and this is 22. And the conventional spins at 1300 RPM and this 1360, as you can see.
Okay, now, well, I have a question here.
Yes?
I'm sure the audience has the same question. Turn this off so they can hear a little better.
Oops.
Off is in the middle.
Yeah.
I've been saying that the Kepi motor consumes one third the amount of energy of a normal fan, and you just said that a normal fan consumes 40 watts, but this one's consuming 22 watts. That's about half. Uh-huh. So help us out with the, I'm getting a disconnect here.
First of all, it's important to say, Sterling, that there are many different types of motors in the market.
Right.
When we say one third, we are comparing to monophase motors, induction motors.
Uh-huh.
Their efficiency is very low. But they represent most of the products you find in the market.
And what would they consume for the same amount of power?
A conventional fan for this, exactly this size, using this blade, is 45 watts
45.
Here in Brazil. 45.
Okay.
In the first speed, the maximum speed,
uh-huh.
And minimum speed, it consumes 30 watts.
Okay.
So we have 30 and 45. If you add these two, the average will be 30 plus 45. 75 divided per 2, we are speaking about 37 watts,
okay.
And a half, 37 watts average consumption. In this case of the Kepi motor, take a look now. Keep this number in mind, 37.5 okay. Watts
right.
Average. We have 22 here for the first speed, right?
That's the highest speed. Uh-huh.
And then I'll put the lowest speed. The lower speed we are speaking about 990, about, which is
almost 1,000
equivalent RPM. To the other speed.
Okay.
But this motor is consuming 12. But do you remember that I said to you that it's easier for us to insert a resistor
right.
To make the speed?
Right.
If I take out the resistor and I use the voltage to diminish the speed, the consumption of this motor will be 4 watts.
Okay.
So we are talking, but that was just a trick I used because
right.
It's cheaper and easier to do.
Right.
But if I take 4 watts plus 22 that we have, we add 26
yeah.
Divided per 2, we are talking about 13. You have to compare 13 with 37.5, almost 39. We are still speaking in one third.
Okay. So in order to get to the one third, you'd have to do some kind of circuitry to make the resistor unnecessary.
Yeah, exactly.
But philosophically or mathematically, it's one third.
Yes, and I uh-huh. Can show you that. If I put in the higher speed
uh-huh.
And I lower down the voltage with this device here until it gets to 900, something like 900 that we are talking about, 890, right?
Okay.
This is consuming 5 watts, so we are talking about 5 and 22 1 watt more, but this it still keeps the average of 1/3 in consumption.
Okay. And also, you were saying something earlier about that if you use stronger neodymium magnets and maybe a different winding, you could get more efficiency too?
Exactly. The shape of the magnet, why do we use those cylinder stack magnets? Because it's the easiest one to find in the market. Yeah, the cheapest, the easiest. And the magnets we are using is N42. If we get N50 in a market, they will be much more economical than this. It depends on what you want to get.
Right, efficient, but more expensive.
More expensive, this you have to choose.
Right, also I think this would be a good time to mention that you have more advanced designs. And in the laboratory that I was able to visit earlier with you, you've got several poles, and you've got even some overunity measurements by a very sophisticated laboratory, 137% efficiency, and that this is kind of the next generation that you're working on. This would be maybe up to a horsepower. You could get up to maybe 10 horsepower with the more advanced designs. The stuff that's coming along is going to be even better than this, but what you have here is nominally 1/3 of what a normal fan is going to consume.
Exactly. Okay. If you know, if you know, the more polarities one motor has, the more efficient it is. And this motor has no limits in terms of how many polarities you can put in it. So the efficiency can go as close to 100% as you want. And if you use the turbo system, which is a collector of the peak energies, then you can have the overunities.
So now, are we ready to go to the makeup section?
Let's go.
Okay. As we go to this final step, you're gonna see that this is a handcrafted piece of equipment. This isn't something that was made in China a million at a time for $20 at the local store that lasts a few days or a few months, and then you throw it away and you go get another one for $20. This is a more expensive piece of equipment, but it's handcrafted and it's got a personal touch. These K's are sought out by hand and applied by Gilbert. He does the painting and there's a personality here. And you can do this as well with your product. It's not something where you have an assembly line and everything's exactly the same. This is something where you can put your personal pride and your personal, your characteristic into this product. Feel proud about it.
Some of which are very practical. You know, for example, to designate whether it's 110 or 120, you can buy stickers in any printing shop, you know, relatively cheaply, you know. You just cut them out. And we have one sticker that we put on the bottom that shows that this is a social project in benefit of the community. And then of course there's the logo. You know, we get these, they're stickers, you know, you take it off and then put them on the front here. These are kind of nice. And here, for example, this is an older model. This one is about 2 years old. It's a friend of ours, and we brought it in just to upgrade it, you know. So the engineers, they fine-tuned the motor and I waxed it again. And it used to have a decal in the front, a sticker in the front, which I just didn't like that. I thought it was a little cheap looking. So speaking with Cesar, we came up with the idea, let's make one out of wood, okay? So it has a much nicer look to it. I don't know if you can see it from there very well, but it's in relief, it's just nicer, and it's all done by hand. What I do is I just, we have a aluminum, you know, and you can either get a press and punch it out, which I don't have yet, so I just cut them out by hand. This is aluminum, so just scissors. Just, you know, make a circle, cut it out, then I spray paint them, I spray a primer on there, and then the color. Okay? Then once I got that, then I get a K. The K's, they come from the carpenters like this. And then I paint the sides of them. And in this case, these red ones, I have a wax that has a red pigment in them. And in the end, they come out like this. Okay, then I just glue them on. to the this aluminum thing. This, and then afterwards, I put a couple of screws in the back to hold them on. You know, they're glued on with a super glue, and then I screw them on in the back to hold them on. Okay, and then these go on the grill. You know, the front grill. And I do that with a hot glue, what's called a hot glue. It's a very all-purpose, you know, you just glue it on in the back here. I also sprayed it black just to kind of, you know, these hot glue things that look like licorice, you know, they're very good for, these can be put on the, either the plastic ones or the metal ones. They work very well. And, you know, when it comes to me in the beginning, you know, they in the carpenter work, they have these wood things, and then what this is they are laminated, you know, they're like leaflets, and you can choose whatever kind you want, you know. These are the ones that I'm presently working with. It's a group of colors here that they put on, and then what I'm doing in the finishing work, basically, I'm just waxing them. You know, I think the wax, it has like a more natural look to it. And depending on where you live, you know, this particular wax here, this is a water base. It's very nice because it dries quickly. And I just give it a two or three coats and it comes out nice. It's not too shiny. I don't like to varnish them because I don't want to get them too shiny. And the wax has a nice look to it. And our line is more Art Deco is the line. And actually, I don't have very many Art Decos because the last holiday season we had here recently, everything went out the door, even my models. So I don't have very many things. But sometimes we go a little bit overboard, or people ask for special types of things. So sometimes it's very good to have to expand a bit, you know. For example, we had a guy, he wanted a fan to match his Ferrari. And so we told him, oh, no, sorry, but our line is Art Deco. And he said, but I'll pay you anything for this kind of a, okay, look, pal, in 1 week you're going to have a Ferrari fan. Okay, so we came up with this. And this was actually Roberto's idea, how to get this guy a Ferrari fan. And he loved it. This is another one that we've made since then. And we're all the time communicating between the different departments, you know, for ideas and things. Here, this is another one that's kind of an ecological look. So it has the natural wood with green on it. This is a kind of favorite model, this one here. This is a real gold wood. In Portuguese, it's called Cereja Dourado, which means golden cherry wood, okay? And then as it has a kind of a blonde look to it, here in the shop, we call this the Marilyn model. Okay, it's all goldish type of thing. What I do is I just take the... we buy these recycled plastic parts, you know. This is the very inexpensive. This is the blade. And then I put any kind of a leaflet, you know, they get leafleted. And then I spray, in this case, I spray it gold. So it has a kind of a certain type of a look for this particular model. Okay, this golden cherry wood.
Gilbert, there is one thing that I wanted to mention that I think is kind of cool about what you brought as an artist to this. Before, the shafts were quite long, and you said, you know, that just looks a little bit overwhelming. Can't we make them a little smaller? And the motor's small enough, they just shrunk this down a little bit. Looks much more sleek. There's just a little thing that he added that the engineers just didn't really pick up on.
You know, Sterling, this is a very interesting thing about the relationship between the function of something and aesthetics. Mm-hmm. Because I was saying to Cesar, you know, Cesar, this bulb in the back, it would look nicer if it were smaller. Of course, on fans, you don't find motors this small. Normally, they're huge, they're ugly, you know. I said, if we can get this a little bit smaller, it would look nicer. And so, they made it smaller, and then afterwards, we realized that the little space that was in there was creating a kind of an echo. And so making them smaller, there's no more noise now. They're completely silent.
Almost.
Yeah, almost silent, you know? As silent as you can possibly get. You hear little turning things, but no like motor noise, you know? And so We just thought that was an interesting principle that goes on. That's just an example of working aesthetics with the function of something. One is linked to the other.
Isn't there a step in here where you actually have them run for a period of time to make sure that they're going to last? When does that happen?
Yeah, before they come to me, they go to the testing table. And they're tested there for a couple of days. We just let them run day and night.
And then at this point, they're ready to go out the door.
Yes. You know, what happens is that in practical terms, many times, I'm all the time communicating with all of the departments. Really, the departments are interdependent because sometimes I can't get it very nice. For example, if something's not cut well, or if there's some kind of a mark that's difficult to get out, we have a principle that is, I'll tell you what, the secret of how to work together in a way that works, that functions, so that the company can go forward. And our secret is that in most companies, they hide the mistakes. You know, everybody hides the mistakes that they do because they don't want to get fired or whatever, but this is not a capitalist company. And so we reveal the mistakes to each other. This is a basic principle, you know? And you have to create a certain ambiance, a certain environment of tolerance to see the mistakes, okay? Because correcting the mistakes, you get a better product and you develop. You develop personally. When people show you your mistakes in a constructive way, of course, you know, with good intentions, then you can correct those mistakes and become a better professional, even a better person. And in fact, we have a weekly feedback program that we do that corrects, you can even go deeper in psychological life. For example, a salesperson who's being a little bit too aggressive with clients or too arrogant, or somebody who wants to boss everybody around, or somebody who's suddenly getting lazy. So we even talk to each other about inner shortcomings, let's say, you know. So this is a secret, to be able to be open enough and have a tolerance level whereby we can correct each other, both in emotional life and in practical terms. And if you can achieve that kind of ambient, then for sure your company will develop. It will explode, you'll go forward, and the people in it develop it. This is what we call the trilogical enterprise model that we use. And so for me, this is like essential in order to get something out the door that's really good. And you know why so many times, have you ever called customer service to some place? Have you ever tried calling customer service to see how to be abused?
Dial one for two.
You know why? Because in the companies, they're full of mistakes and many things come back and they don't want to deal with it, you know? And so this is an inversion in the companies that are going on nowadays. We have to be able to be tolerant enough to see each other's mistakes. And you know, for example, Cesar and Roberto, my friends here, they know everything about my pathology and I know everything about their pathology, but we're still very good friends. You know, there's no problem in reality, you know?
I should mention that Gilbert actually was at the Occupy New York for the first 6 months when they started that. And can you imagine him going around doing his piano thing, talking to people, taking the mic, encouraging people, getting them to think, working through their pathologies. He was kind of a leavening influence there. So as they would have their protests, there were actually more celebrations. They weren't, you know, with the signs and shouting and angry. They were happy and smiling, and then the cops came and hauled them off and waving. And, you know, that's not always what was on camera, but that was kind of what he was pushing for among the people that he was talking to. He had a lot of influence there. You want to go to kepimotor.com to learn about the motors, to get the kits, to get the plans, to talk about building your own local business that works on these things. And if you wanted to go to the conferences, that's icat.wf to learn about the concepts. And also there are links from the kepimotor.com website about the trilogy concept, I just want to thank you for going through this little tour with us, and I hope that you've been inspired to both be appreciative of what they've done here, but also think about what can you do locally to revive your economy, to revive your town. As they were starting to paint this hotel, other people in town started painting their stuff, and the whole town is being elevated by their interaction. They're giving free classes to the kids in town. It's such an amazing thing going on here. So we haven't even scratched the surface. I just want you to, in this little tip of the iceberg, to see the phenomenal things that they're doing and you could do too.